All right, welcome back to our Introduction to Machine Learning for Material Science. Today we'll be looking into section 5, which is actually building our default model and doing our assessment of that model, seeing how well we're performing. So far we've looked at some of the initial sections on data inspection, data cleaning. We've done feature generation and feature engineering, which have set up the inputs to the model. And then last time we looked at how we're going to set up the evaluation for the model. And now we're going to put all those together and finally build a model and look at, you know, what is the default performance that we have. And when I'm saying default there, I mean we're going to use just the default settings from the model that we're using. So we're using a package called scikit-learn to set up all the models for us, and they have some default settings that come with them. So we'll just use those and see how well we can do. So I'm going to click on the hyperlink here and we'll jump down into section 5. So again, as I'm running through, I'm just hitting shift enter to execute some of the cells here. And with this first cell, we are kind of off to the races. So we set up our model and we fit it and have it available to us right now. So we've trained the model with one step. It's quick, it's easy, it happened almost instantly. And that's one because our data set's fairly small and the model isn't super complex. But sometimes this will take, you know, a bit of time. If you have a data set that's thousands and thousands of data points and your model is much more complex. But really, it's not hard to just fit a model. It's a single line of code, basically. We output a few things about the model here. So we see the tree depth, and we have, we're printing out the importances of the features here. This isn't super important to dive into the details on, but if you're wanting to learn a little bit more, you can spend a little time maybe thinking about those or understanding what's going on there. But for now, we'll keep moving forward, and we'll move on to the next section here. So if I go down here, we make a few predictions initially. The reason we do this is we are pulling out, you know, a few data sets or a few data points here that are, you know, somewhat interesting to look at. So we have silicon and we have silicon oxide. These are two fairly well understood semiconductors. So silicon obviously is hugely important in all of the electronics that we're using. And what we see is that right now the predictions, it's saying, I think silicon's band gap is 2 and silica or silicon oxide is 6. And the reason we predict these right now, before we dive into anything further, is again, just to drive home this point of, you know, we can definitely make predictions right now. So I can tell you, here's what the model thinks. But right now we don't have any way to know, like, should we believe those results? Do we, what if we didn't actually know the band gap of either of those? Like, how would we know whether or not to believe the predictions? And this is what, why we need to do this model evaluation step, which is what we're going to do next. So if I keep going down, now we can start looking at some of these assessment techniques that we were talking about previously. So this first step here is putting together what we call a parity plot. So I'll start on the left, just explaining, you know, what we're looking at. So what we're looking at here is the measured band gap value. So this is the known values that we have on the x-axis. Again, look, we can see they range from 0 to 13, which is what we saw when we did our initial data inspection. And on the y-axis, what we have is our predicted values. And the closer they are to this dashed line in the middle, generally we would think that those are, you know, closer to correct. Or the smaller differences from the line, the less error there is. And it looks like these are all, like, really close to the line right now, which is potentially really good. On the right side, we see things are a little different. So we have, you know, a bunch of values that are close to the line on the left side here, and then some values that are just really far away here. So if we looked at the value of that error for this point in particular, in the middle of this right plot, what we can see is that the measured value is, you know, a little less than 6, but the predicted value is less than 2. It's maybe 1.8 or 1.9. So there's a huge error in this prediction here. And the difference between these plots, which you might have already noticed here with the labels on them, is this is the training data on the left, and then on the right is the test data. So remember we made those splits in the previous section where we said this is the data the model has seen before, and then the right is the data the model hasn't seen before. And what this highlights is that the model can think it's performing really well if we just look at the training set, or we might think that the model is performing really well. But when we actually go to predict new data, it can perform much differently. So on the right is the data that it hasn't seen at all before, and now it has these huge errors in some of the points. So what if this was the the same point I was looking at a second ago. This one by six. Like, what if that was the point we were trying to predict, and we said, oh, look, this material is great. It has, you know, a prediction of around two or so, and maybe that's what we really want. But in actuality, its band gap is, you know, up at six, and we would waste a bunch of time because we made a prediction that was really far off. And we wouldn't know that if we just looked at the training data results. So if we just trained all our data and said, how well do we predict the training data, we'd think that we were perfect every time. So this is definitely one of the reasons why we have to make this split between training and testing data, is because the models are so smart that they can do something called overfitting, where it's fit very closely onto all this training data, but we might say that it's overfit to the training data so that it does not extrapolate well onto the new predictions that we're making. So I've been talking a little bit about the kind of qualitative observations of the parity plots here. You can also numerically represent these errors. So there's a number of metrics here which are shown on this table below. I'm not going to dive into too much of the details here, but basically these are ways to, you know, quantitatively describe what are the errors present. And they show the same thing. So on the training data column here, we see this error, this RMSE error is, you know, 0.0003 EV, which would be amazing. It would be crazy good. But on the test data, it's 1.2 EV. So it's, you know, orders of magnitude worse in its prediction there. This is, you know, one way that we can assess, you know, how well is our default model performing. And the conclusion here is probably, you know, not very good. If the error here in the predictions are over, you know, an EV, that would be very hard to get a useful prediction out of the model. So we can scroll down and keep going through the next sections. And what we'll look at is, one thing is what we'll look at is a little bit of visualization of, like, what is this model actually doing? That's one thing we haven't really talked about so far. And in the interest of time, we don't really have a huge amount of time to dive into it. But what I would encourage you to do on your own is look up decision tree models. So the type of model that we're trying to use here is a decision tree, and we can visualize it here in this plot, or in this kind of schematic. The really kind of quick and dirty version of this is that the decision tree is just making, like the name sounds, decisions at a number of different nodes within the tree. So here's an example where you have data that's coming as input to this node, and what it's saying is it's going to make a decision about splitting the data on this node. So it's looking at this specific feature. This is BCC volume, PA composition average. It's not super important that we know what that means, but that's one of the features. And it's saying, is this feature less than or equal to 0.077? If so, it's going to make one of the splits, and if it's not, it's going to make the other split. So what's happening is that it's splitting on this feature, and that's how it's making a decision about what prediction should it make. So if it makes this split, if the value was, you know, below this value, then it's going to make this prediction. It's going to say it should be 10.48. Whereas if it's on the other split, it's going to make this prediction, 9.33. So this is how the model makes predictions. It makes a number of these splits further up on the right on this plot, and it progressively goes through the tree. And whenever you get to the bottom of the tree, that's how it makes a prediction. So here it's predicting 10, 9.3. If it gets to this end node, it's 7.7. So you see that's how it makes all the different predictions. So I'm going to minimize that again because it's very large. If you're looking at the outputs here, I don't think I mentioned this earlier, you can single click on the left side of these outputs to expand or contract them. You can also double click just to get rid of them. So for now, I'm going to minimize it so it's not taking up a huge amount of space. But yeah, if you're wanting to look into the model and see what it's actually doing, that's a kind of fun way to do that. So if we keep moving forward here, we get on to the next section, which is on optimizing hyperparameters. So we looked through the default model, and what it's looking like so far is that it's able to predict, you know, okay, but it's not great. So the overall kind of errors that we're seeing are fairly high. And what we're going to do is we're going to dive in and see, you know, how can we actually change the model and improve it going forward.